football celebrates its centennial year on ABC, the number one network for sports.
Saturday, November 22nd, 1969, the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where the Wolverines of the University of Michigan, coached by Bo Schembechler, meet the nation's number one college football team, the Buckeyes of Ohio State University, coached by Woody Hayes, in a battle that will decide the Big Ten Championship. College football today is brought to you by the Lincoln National Life Insurance Company. Get complete financial planning in the Lincoln hat. And by Antilete Xerox Antifreeze, the antifreeze that won't run out on you. The city of Ann Arbor is located in a picturesque area of southeastern Michigan, 50 miles west of Detroit, 50 miles from the Ohio border. It's the home of the University of Michigan and the location of the largest college-owned football stadium in the world, the Michigan Stadium, seating capacity 101,001, but which today may very well be over 103,000. For nearly three-quarters of a century, the football teams of these two neighboring states, Michigan and Ohio, have been engaging in a rivalry that is truly second to none in terms of intensity, conference championship, and national title implications. And seldom in this long football tradition has there been a day as perfect for a showdown battle as this one. It's sunny, the temperature is in the mid-40s, and for the first time in history, the teams will be playing on artificial turf. So wetness or slipperiness due to this past week's 6 inches of snow will have no bearing whatsoever on the game. And ABC is very proud to be on hand in Ann Arbor to bring you this key game. It begins a full day of live sports, about 8 hours in all. Right after this game, we'll be going to Rome, Italy, live for the middleweight championship of the world fight. And then at 6 o'clock Eastern Standard Time, to the Los Angeles Coliseum for the showdown battle between Southern California and UCLA. All in all, it should be quite a day. Hello, everybody. I'm Bill Fleming, along with Lee Groskopf, welcoming you to the 66th battle between Michigan and Ohio State. And for a game filled with emotion and more significance, Lee, it would be hard to find another one.
Well, I tell you, I'm excited, and it's all here, the drama. Ohio State fighting to be number one, Michigan looking for the Rose Bowl, and Woody Hayes would like to win big today because perhaps then Ohio State could be named the team of the century.
Should be mentioned here, too, that Ohio State has already tied its own record of 17 consecutive Big Ten wins. A win today would make number 18 and also number 23 in a row.
And what personnel we have to look at today and some interesting parallels. Quarterbacks Rex Kern and Don Moorhead, a couple of fine tight ends in Jim Mandich and Jan White. Two great middle guards in Henry Hill and Jim Stillwagon, and a defensive superstar in Jack Tatum, who we're going to be talking a lot about this afternoon.
We'll not only be talking a lot about him, we'll be talking with him. We'll be talking also with Woody Hayes and Jim Mandich. So I think you'll get a kick out of some of the personalities that will be involved here today. First of all is number 10. For Ohio State University, he is Rex Kern, a sleight-of-hand artist if there ever was one with a football.
He's a great one. He does a little bit of everything, one of the most versatile quarterbacks you're ever going to see, showing here that he can also scramble. He's been able to come up with a big play on third down. He runs the option play. The key man here is Jim Otis, the fullback. Kern on the triple option, faking to Otis, and fighting for the extra yardage, once again showing those great competitive instincts. He throws the ball well, both on the move or standing still. And one of his favorite receivers is Larry Zelina, who led the team in rushing average last year, but will also catch the football. He has another fine target in his right end, number 82, Bruce Jankowski. His favorite pattern has been the post pattern, hitting deep down the middle. And as we see here, he can catch that football in a crowd. Another fine man to look at, 82, Bruce Jankowski. Jim Otis, the fullback, has been a starter for 3 years, and Ohio State has had some good fullbacks. This time, Otis on the trap play. The off-tackle play is his big one, but he also runs the trap. And keep your eye peeled here, because we thought Otis had the ball, but it's Leo Hayden. Great faking by Kern, and Hayden the outside threat after the great fake to Jim Otis. And he can fly, Bill.
That pretty well shows you just exactly what kind of running Ohio State and what kind of passing they can do. I think one significant thing about the defense is they started 11 players against TCU, first game of the season. Those 11 have started every single game, so it's a very durable bunch. And, of course, it's led by number 32, Jack Tatum, who will be all over the field today.
And what an athlete this guy is. He has sprinter speed. He's over 200 pounds. He blitzes the quarterback. He covers passes. He shuts off the run. And just for example, watch him here.
Well, Jack, in this day and age of offensive football, it's very rare to find somebody who just revels in playing defense like you do. You really love it out there, don't you?
Right. I love to play defense since I was in high school.
Did you play both ways?
I played fullback and middle linebacker.
Well, you know, on defense itself, are you given any latitude by Coach McCullough or Coach Hayes as to what to do and where to go on any particular play?
Well, depends on where they line up. I can line up mostly depending on where I want to. But, like, I have certain specific areas to cover, so I've been told what to do.
Well, sometimes you're rushing through. Other times you're actually playing as a pass defender, and it must involve maybe as much running as an offensive back during a game.
Yeah, I think so. Most of us backwards. It's kind of tired.
The words of Jack Tatum, All-America cornerback for the Ohio State Buckeyes. And in a moment, a chat with Woody Hayes, head coach of the Bucks, twice coach of the year, and some of his candid comments.
Last Tuesday, Olive, a senior VP, and Cantankerous Walnut were discussing retirement plans over a cup of coffee when Hat, a Lincoln National financial planner, stopped by.
Just the man we need, said Olive.
Said Walnut.
He's just an insurance man.
That and more, said Hat. I coordinate your assets to plan the future you want.
Fish feathers.
How? First, I determine your assets. Next, I work in your future plans. Then I ask our Lincoln computers for a program to match your needs.
Life insurance.
Sneered Walnut.
Not entirely. After all, at Lincoln, we have a great range of financial plans for sophisticated people like Olive. He probably needs a combination of annuities, an estate plan, investments, life insurance, savings.
Keeping yourself in good shape is the best protection you can have.
Just then, a rampaging nutcracker seized Walnut and smashed him into seven small pieces. Lincoln National Financial Planning is very comforting if you get caught in a squeeze.
Woody, you know, this season must be particularly gratifying to you. It always is great to have potential, but to realize that potential is the ultimate.
Well, I tell you, until the game is over, Bill, nothing is great. If we win this Michigan game, then I'll have to say it's the greatest season of my life, yes.
But you know,
we've got to go ahead and win this one first before we do any talking at all.
Yes, I'm sure that's true, because any Michigan game could go either way, regardless of what's happened before.
And we won't let it go against us, but we want to play the ball game. Then we'll have plenty of time to accept plaudits, and it'll all be in the past then.
I think the thing that's been remarkable, though, to your fellow coaches, Woody, is the fact that each week this team has been able to play just superlative football. There has not been a letdown. There hasn't been any complacency at all. I think it's a great tribute to you and your staff.
I think it's a greater tribute to the youngster who plays, and although we did select him, we'll take that credit. But it takes a quality kid to not let all this adulation and publicity get to him. They haven't done it. What we've asked them to do, they've gone right ahead and done it, and I think that's the reason they're still winning.
Last week, of course, there was a tremendous amount of pressure, and all of a sudden, you looked up on the scoreboard, and there's 28 points for Ohio State.
Jan White and Bruce Jankowski are wingbacks.
Apparently, we had technical trouble with the tape that we recorded yesterday after Ohio State worked out of the Michigan Stadium. And you were hearing the comments of Woody Hayes. We'll be getting back to that in a moment. But right now, live here in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, it gives you a rough idea of some of the activity going on before this annual battle and what a clash this one should be. These two teams started meeting back in 1897. I think the rivalry is as intense as any you will ever find in football. This is the Michigan team dressed in the maize and blue, the home uniforms, working out, and just above them at the top of your screen, you see the Ohio State University Buckeye Band getting ready to come out and perform before the game. At the opposite end of the field, the Ohio State Buckeye team. And when they came out through the tunnel on the far side, some 22,000 of their rooters really gave them a welcome. And there's one of the few fumbles they've had this year, Lee.
I'll tell you, the noise here is just overwhelming. I think by the end of the afternoon, everyone's ears are just going to be about bursting. What tremendous excitement.
And there's the man that we have been talking about, Woody Hayes, 56 years old, who is in his 19th year as the head coach of the Buckeyes, and what a record they have had underneath him.
Woody has really been in the public eye lately. All of the national periodicals have been featuring Woody. One of the things that they have noted is the fact that he equates football to war, and he likes to quote from generals, particularly General Sherman. He once said that General Sherman ran an option play through the entire South.
And that young man right there, number 10, Rex Kern, comes from the hometown of General Sherman, oddly enough, Lancaster, Ohio.
And someone noted that both Rex Kern and General Sherman were both redheads. It shows the great interest that they have in Lancaster.
I think you can see there, number 27, that's Don Moorhead, the quarterback of Michigan. You just see his number on the side, Bo Schembechler. The head coach of Michigan has an interesting story. He played under Woody Hayes at Miami of Ohio and then served under him as an assistant at Ohio State University. We'll be back to talk more about this Michigan-Ohio State battle in the Michigan Stadium in just a moment.
But, boss, a beer's a beer.
Give Billy one of them hams. You know I've roped a steer and had a beer. From here to the Rio Grande, but a beer is a beer is a beer is a beer until you've tasted hams. Have another hams. The beer born in the land of sky-blue waters where the flavor runs deep.
A beer is a beer is a beer is a beer.
I'll have me another hams.
Until you've tasted hams.
Come learn the secret of Bally High. Italian Swiss Colony Bally High. A light wine with the taste of the tropics. Go native. Or serve it the way you've always served fine wine. Come explore. Bally High.
Well, I think we have our technical problems repaired now, and so let's go back and rejoin those comments of Woody Hayes recorded yesterday after the Ohio State worked out.
They accept it, and they'll go on from there. Woody, let's talk just a moment about this Michigan team. Obviously, you've looked at them on film. Sark has scouted them. You must have some opinion formed in your own mind about the team.
I try to make a policy of never talking much about our opponents. It might be misconstrued, and I certainly wouldn't want to build their confidence. They have some weaknesses, just the same as we do, and we'll try to find theirs, and I'm sure they'll make every effort to find ours tomorrow. But they are a fine team, or they couldn't have won as decisively as they have in the last four games.
You know, we receive a lot of mail during the course of the season, and a lot of it's good mail, a lot of it's bad, and
say that most of it is good, though, isn't it, Bill?
Yeah, I think so.
I'd say 95 to 98% of the mail we get is always good.
But the one question that keeps coming up where Woody Hayes' name is involved, they say you're a man of no mercy.
You know, frankly, I don't care much what they think. I know this, and I'll put it as frankly as I can make it, that we would like to be the best team in this nation. There's been talk about ours being the best team of the century, and I'm not going to hold our kids back. I will not do it to hold down a couple of touchdowns if that's what it takes to, by the margin of victory, to show us to be truly outstanding. I will not vote against my kids, and yet we've been playing them about half the ball game the last two games, so if people want to feel that way, that's usually bitterness and pettiness that I don't have any time for.
Woody, are you going back to Vietnam?
I want to go back at Christmas time. There are a couple things might come up and might make it later for me in the year. But I would most like to go back at Christmas time because I think the young fellows over there would appreciate it more than at any other time.
Boy, what an armload of film you'll have this year to show.
Yeah, we'll have a lot of good film to show as we did last year. I got out there last year very timely, right after the Rose Bowl, in 2 days. And they did appreciate it. And that's why a man likes to go.
Woody, the best of luck to you. I know you and your Ohio State Buckeyes would like nothing better to set a new all-time consecutive victory mark in the Big Ten of 18 victories, especially over Michigan.
We'd certainly like to. We'd like to, Bill. Thank you.
To the comments of head coach Woody Hayes of Ohio State, which we recorded yesterday in the Michigan Stadium while his team was working out preparing for this game. Back for more of the pregame activity in the huge Michigan Stadium in just a moment.
To spend their time making and eating great food, but not cleaning up after. There's Teflon 2 certified cookware. It's no stick and very easy to clean. Teflon 2, to keep cleanup in its place.
We're going to drive home a point. about new anti-leak Xerex antifreeze. It stops most common radiator leaks just like that. We guarantee it will stop and prevent leaks in your car radiator for a full year. Or just write DuPont and get your money back. Only Xerex antifreeze is guaranteed not to run out on you.
All lovers of Ohio State football will enjoy this ceremony by the band. Traditional it is. It's the spelling out in script of Ohio and the traditional dotting of the I with the tuba. Let's watch and let's listen. So there it is, the traditional script, Ohio, and you heard the tremendous roar go up from this partisan crowd of Ohio for their great band, which is performing here prior to the game. And we will have a record crowd on hand here today of better than 103,000. And now the Michigan band under the direction of William D. Ravelli, and incidentally the Ohio band was under the direction of Charles Spahn, is poised on the far side in the tunnel on the eastern side of the Michigan Bowl. And here they come at a cadence of 220 beats to the minute. Michigan fanfare, after which Michigan will turn down the field to the north end and play the traditional fight song, The Victors. The drum major this year is Mark Brown of Livermore, Kentucky. Attempt to throw his baton over the goalpost and catch it, which has been in the past symbolic of Michigan victory. music you are hearing is the famous Victor's March written by the late Louis L. Bell when he was a student at the University of Michigan. He was so inspired by a Michigan victory over then-feared Chicago that he came back on the train, and on his journey back to Ann Arbor in the early 1900s, he penned this wonderful song. Dr. Charles Spahn, who is the director of bands at Ohio State University, will lead the Michigan band in our national anthem. The flagpole is at the south end of the stadium with the color guard there now. National anthem having a particularly solemn significance today because, as you know, it was just exactly 6 years ago today. President John F. Kennedy was assassinated in Dallas. Now let's take a look at the Michigan team of this year. Truly a remarkable team in the fact that the Wolverines had faltered at midseason and all of a sudden they've come on strong. They have a mark of 7-2 so far. They have won four in a row after losing to Michigan State, a team that many feel they should not have lost to.
And like Ohio State, their offense starts with their quarterback, Don Moorhead, a man who last year was an understudy, learned mostly from the bench behind Dennis Brown. He has passed for over 700 yards this year, but his total offense is over 1,000 yards. And we just saw why. He can run as well as throw. Mostly he is an intermediate passer, but occasionally he'll throw deep, as we see here to Bill Harris, number 80, who, by the way, makes a great catch. The leading receiver for the Wolverines is tight end Jim Mandich, the team captain, who runs this pattern, the hook a lot, also the crossing pattern. And as we see him fight for a touchdown, you can see why he's an All-American candidate. And yesterday, you had a chance to get to know this young man a little bit better.
Jim Mandich, number 88. Well, Jim, as captain of this Michigan team, you must have some very personal...
As you know, Bill, I've never been on a team that has defeated Ohio State. And unfortunately, we're going into our third year, my third year, against the supposedly greatest Ohio State team of all time. But this doesn't bother me or the team in any way. We're really looking forward to the opportunity to play Ohio State and feel that our chances are better than anyone else of defeating the Ohio State team.
What's it going to really take as far as Michigan is concerned? Luck?
Luck could be a factor, but I'd rather rely on just every man playing their best game of the year, their greatest game tomorrow against Ohio State.
Best of luck to you, Jim. I know it's something that you've wanted since the moment you entered Michigan.
Thank you very much. Sure is.
Well, the question seems to be, what was the reason for Michigan's resurgence? I think it really involved a man with the name of Billy Taylor. He's a sophomore, wears number 42, and he started after the Michigan State game against Minnesota.
Well, that was 5 weeks ago, and since then he's averaged better than 200 yards a game, which is slightly fantastic. He was playing behind Glenn Doughty. And here we see the fact that he has great leg strength, shiftiness, and the open field speed. He busted about five tackles en route to a 33-yard touchdown. And watch again the way he can break these tackles. One, two, a good block, and off he goes, 69 yards for a touchdown.
And he holds the Big Ten record this year of 84 yards. That's the longest touchdown run in the conference. It was against Illinois. Well, one thing is certain, Michigan is emotionally high, just about as high as a team can get. Whether it's enough to beat the tremendous Buckeyes, we'll soon find out. From the Michigan Stadium at Ann Arbor, this has been College Football Today. This is Bill Fleming along with Lee Grosskopf, inviting you to stay tuned now for NCAA College Football. Today's game featuring the Buckeyes of Ohio State versus the Wolverines of the University of Michigan.
Eve Arden and Paul Forward star in Name Only Tuesday night at 8:30, 7:30 Central Time on the ABC Movie of the Week. Then Robert Young tries to help a young man who can't shake the effects of a bad trip on LSD on Marcus Welby, M.D., Tuesday on ABC.
College football celebrates its centennial year on ABC, the number one network for sports.
On the 100th anniversary of college football, ABC Sports presents...
Give me an N!
N!
Give me a C!
C!
Give me an A!
A!
Give me another A!
A!
Fight ball!
Today's game features the Wolverines of the University of Michigan versus the Buckeyes of Ohio State University. This ABC Sports exclusive is brought to you live and in color by the Institute of Life Insurance on behalf of the life insurance companies in America. Life insurance, when someone's counting on you. By Goodyear, the only maker of polyglass tires. By Chevrolet. Chevrolet is on the move with great new models for 1970, including the exciting cars in your Chevrolet dealer sports department.
And by Wilson Certified. Marvelous meats made better by Wilson.
...103,588 fans in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, and here come the Buckeyes of Ohio State onto the field for the 66th meeting between Michigan and Ohio State. The Michigan band is on the field, and here come the Maize and Blue Warriors of Michigan. Ohio State coming into today's game, winners of 22 straight, 8 this season by tremendous scores. The Buckeyes have averaged over 46 points in their games. They have allowed their opponents only 8 on an average. The Michigan Wolverines, coming into today's game, have a record of 7-2, playing one more game than Ohio State. The Wolverines started out strong, faltered against Missouri, lost to Michigan State. But since that time, look at those scores against Minnesota, Wisconsin, Illinois, and Iowa. 44 points per game to only 5 for their opponents. Strangely enough, these two teams come into today's game exactly as they wound up the season of 1968. Ohio State number 1, Michigan number 12. We'll be back for the kickoff in just a moment.
Sometimes I think I'll never grow old. Sometimes I think I'll never grow old. Sometimes I think I'll never grow old. If death don't get me, life definitely will.
When you're 20 years old, becoming 30 is beyond belief. And only people you don't know are 40. But tomorrows have a way of arriving, bearing marriage licenses and birth certificates and school bills. If your tomorrows are arriving this way, shouldn't you review how you've provided for them? We mean your life insurance. Life insurance comes in so many shapes and sizes. Is yours adequate? How long would income from your present program provide the things you want for your family? Enough can turn into too little, too soon. Review your program in this light. Life insurance. When someone's counting on you.
This is Bill Fleming, along with Lee Groskopf, back in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor. We're getting ready for the introduction of the players as this record crowd in this centennial year of college football, 103,588, waiting in great anticipation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the players to be introduced here today. At left end, number 88, Dave Whitfield. At tackle, number 74, Paul Smidlin. Middle guard, number 68, Jim Stillwagon. At tackle, number 79, Bill Urbanek. At end, number 83, Mark DeBevick. Adams. Linebacker, number 62, Phil Strickland. Cornerback, number 32, Jack Tatum. Defensive halfback, Tim Anderson, number 26. Safety man, number 3, Mike Sensabaugh, and the head coach of Ohio State, Woody Hayes. And now for the University of Michigan, at left end, number 90, Mike Keller. At tackle, number 92, Fred Grambo. Middle guard, number 39, Henry Hill. At tackle, number 82, Pete Newell. At end, number 55, Cecil Pryor. Linebacker, number 70, Marty Huff. Linebacker, number 33, Mike Taylor. Wolfman, number 35, Tom Darden. Defensive back, number 29, Barry Pearson. Defensive back, number 24, Brian Healy. Safety man, number 25, Tom Curtis, and the head coach of the Wolverines, Bo Schembechler. Well, there it is, the Wolverines of Michigan and the Buckeyes of Ohio State. Ohio State has won the toss, has elected to receive the football, and that means the Michigan Wolverines will be on defense to start this ball game. Let's get a quick word from Lee Groskopf. Lee?
And right off the bat, let's see if Ohio State does what they have done best, control that football, particularly with the running, the option running of Rex Kern, the quarterback. And he'll be handing off to fullback Jim Otis, mostly on the off-tackle play, as we saw in the pregame show, occasionally on the trap, varying it with the wide plays to Leo Hayden. And when he throws, it could be any number of targets.
These are the Wolverines who will kick off to Ohio State. Michigan dressed in the yellow pants, the blue jerseys, the maize numerals, the maize and blue headgears, and Ohio State in the scarlet and gray with the white jerseys today with the red numerals and the silver helmets. The last time Ohio State lost a football game was in Columbus, Ohio, October the 28th, 1967. It was Illinois that did it, 17-13. They hope to make Michigan their 23rd consecutive victory to victim and their 18th consecutive victim in the Big Ten, which would set a new all-time record. As I mentioned earlier, these two teams coming into today's game are in exactly the same position that they wound up the season of 1968. Ohio State number one in the country and number 12 is Michigan. Dana Coyne, number 36, from Pontiac, Michigan, will kick off. Tom Campana and Larry Zelina are the deep men. We're set to go. Everybody standing in the Michigan Stadium, over 103,000 people. And the battle is on. Campana up to the 25, cuts to the side to the 30, gets to the 43-yard line before he's knocked down by Dana Coyne, the man who kicked the ball off, and Tom Darden. So the Wolverines go on defense. The Buckeyes take the ball at their own 44-yard line, first and 10, and checking into that backfield, Rex Kern, number 10 at quarterback, Leo Hayden, number 22, will be the left halfback. Jim Otis, number 35, the fullback, Larry Zolina, number 16, the right halfback. And split out is Bruce Jankowski, number 82, at the top of your screen. Hearn back to pass in the very first down of the ball game. Decides to run, finds the opening, gets to the 45, cuts outside to midfield. Tries to angle to the sidelines, goes to the 30-yard line in Michigan territory, and he's out of bounds. Run out by Brian Healy, number 24. So on the first play from scrimmage, Rex Kern, brilliant quarterback, runs 25 yards.
And just like we saw in the pregame show, Rex Kern can do it all. That time the scramble, starting on the sprint out to his right, finding daylight back to his left and wisely getting out of bounds. Now immediate field position for the Buckeyes. And don't be surprised if Rex Kern decides to go to the air again.
First and 10 on the 31-yard line in Michigan territory. Hayden starts in motion. Kern pitches back to Otis. Gets a good block from Hayden and spun down to the ground on the 25-yard line. Cecil Pryor, number 55, making the stop for Michigan. A gain of about 6 on the play, making it second down and 4. Give him 7 yards down to the 24-yard line of Michigan.
And to set the stage offensively for Ohio State, they'll be running mostly from a wing tee, or an offense what Woody Hayes refers to as the old button-down shoe, the full house backfield with two tight ends.
Second down and 3 yards to go. Ohio State threatening in the first minute of the ball game, and Jim Otis pile drives his way to the 21-yard line. It'll be very close to a first down, and a Michigan player is flat on the deck right there.
And that man is number 39, Henry Hill, the walk-on candidate. One of the real fine middle guards in the country. Great quickness. Number 39, Henry Hill, who will be watching along with another good one, Jim Stillwagon.
Third down, about a foot and a half to go for a first down for Ohio State. First sequence after receiving the opening kickoff. And off to Otis. He hits Henry Hill, gets his first down, and gets inside the 20 at the 19-yard line. So the Buckeyes have their second first down of the ball game on the Michigan 19-yard line. The last time Ohio State trailed in a ball game was exactly 1 year ago in the Michigan game when Ron Johnson scored the first touchdown to give Michigan a 7-0 lead. However, the Buckeyes came back to score 2. Michigan tied it up. Ohio State went on to win that one big, 50-14. Right now they have the ball, first and 10 on the 19 of Michigan. Hand off to Otis. Big hole opens up. He gets 7 quick yards before he's brought down at the Michigan 13-yard line by Marty Huff. What blocking in that offensive line of Ohio State. Jan White, Dave Cheney, Brian Donovan, Tom DeLone, Alan Jack, Chuck Hutchison, and Bruce Jankowski.
Another play similar to what we saw in our pregame show. The quick trap by fullback Jim Otis, who will run mostly off tackle. We'll vary it with the trap play. And right now, with a slot eye formation, don't be surprised to see Rex Kern go back to that triple option.
Second down, 4 to go. Kern keeping the ball. Gets to the 11-yard line. Tom Curtis, number 25, making the stop for Michigan. Woody Hayes on the phone. This is what he calls his hotline to victory. Third down, about 2 to go.
And always with a short sleeve shirt.
Jan White, left end, checks back into the lineup. He had been replaced by Dick Kuhn at left end. It's third down, 1.5 yards. For the first down on the 11-yard line of Michigan. Ohio State threatening here in the first 3 minutes of play. There is a penalty marker down as Jim Otis went into the line and got across the 10-yard line. Backfield illegally in motion. That's a procedure penalty against Ohio State. He had the first down, by the way, right at the 9-yard line. Or at least he had a... First of all, they signaled it. Now the Michigan captain is being talked to. And Michigan will take the penalty. It's a perfect day for football in Ann Arbor. The temperature in the mid-40s, and despite the fact that there was about 6 inches of snow earlier in the week and a miserable week, the snow was bulldozed off the top of the tartan turf, and as you can see, it's a fast track. So it moves it back to a 3rd and 7, 12 minutes, 3 seconds to go. First quarter, the ball is back on the 15.5-yard line. Tom Campana has come into the Ohio State backfield, replacing Lee Hayden. He's back on the full house tee. Kern, back to pass, is being rushed. Throws it down the middle, he's got his man. It's Otis at the 12-yard line. That'll be short of a first down. Mike Taylor made the original penetration. And number 29, Barry Pearson, made the stop. So it brings up a fourth down, about 2 yards to go. And the question is, will Ohio State try for a field goal here in the first 3.5 minutes of play? Dick Kuhn comes into the lineup and talks to Rex Kern. Apparently no try for the three. The Buckeyes trying to go in for the first down. They have a fourth down and two. Kern gives to Otis. He bangs in hard. It's going to be very close. Henry Hill locked horns with him at the 10-yard line, and Michigan has stopped Ohio State, and the Wolverines take over the football at the 10-yard line, and what a roar.
And what a big play by number 39, Henry Hill, the middle guard we were just talking about.
And it's timeout here in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, and the score, Ohio State nothing, Michigan nothing.
Chevrolet Impala, please report to gate 7. Your car is blocking the exit. That's the red Impala custom coupe with black vinyl roof cover. The one with the hidden radio antenna, hidden windshield wipers. The Chevy with deluxe wheel covers and dual white stripe tires. The Impala with a 350 cubic inch standard V8 and turbo hydromatic transmission. 1970 Chevy custom coupe with rich saddle color interior. The one with
first and 10 for Michigan. The ball on the 10-yard line. Ohio State kept the ball for 3 minutes and 40 seconds after taking the opening kickoff. And now quarterback Don Moorhead sets his team. Hands off to Billy Taylor. Gets about a yard, maybe a yard and a half before a still wagon underneath. Number 68 makes the stop. Here is the goal line, not the goal line, but the 10-yard line stand, and there is number 39, Henry Hill, fighting his man off. And the man who actually makes that penetration is number 33 of Michigan. That is Mike Taylor, the linebacker.
We saw his quickness, his strength, and also the agility and that ability to recover.
Second down, about 8, the ball on the 12. Michigan in possession, there is no score. This is Moorhead trying to turn the end and is cut down at the 15-yard line by Dave Whitfield and Jack Tatum, number 32. No score. Ohio State thrilled this capacity crowd when he took the first play from scrimmage for 25 yards. Here's Tatum getting blocked. And the man throwing the block there is number 42, Billy Taylor. Third down and 5. Ball at the Michigan 15. There's no score. Handoff goes to Taylor, and he's hit hard. And down at the line of scrimmage he goes. Jim Stillwagon making the stop. So it brings up a fourth down, and Mark Werner, number 49, checks into the Michigan backfield. Zelina drops back as the single safety. Michigan will have the wind to its back in the first quarter. The Wolverines lost the toss. Ohio State took the football. Michigan took the goal line. And here is Zelina. He'll have to be facing the wind and the sun. Perfect snap to Werner. And an end-over-end kick sails across midfield and is taken on the fly at the 48. Zelina is missed. He goes to the 35. Slides through to the 32. Still on his feet. One man between him and the goal line, and it's Werner. He knocks him out of bounds at the 15-yard line, the man who punted the ball. What a run by Larry Zelina.
And what a versatile athlete he is. The leading rusher on the team last year with an 8.7-yard average, an outstanding receiver, and as we just saw, very dangerous on punt returns.
His change of pace was really something miraculous. Watch him take the ball here and just shoot right by the first wave down, right there.
And the important thing is to bust that first tackle on the return middle. He breaks to the outside, and as you said, shows the great change of pace.
Live now, the ball is pitched back, and it was almost intercepted. Jim Otis was the ball carrier, and number 35 was Tom Darden, the Wolfman, who almost got between Rex Kern and Jim Otis. That would have been spectacular.
It certainly would have. You know, I get a kick out of the terminology that we're hearing nowadays. It's Rover back, Wolfman, et cetera, et cetera. Last week we had Wreckers and Stingers in Atlanta.
Second down and 11, a loss of a yard on the play. That's only the second time in his career that Otis has been thrown for a loss. Kern spots his man down the middle. It's Jan White at the 5-yard line. And it should be a first down. The Buckeyes had to go to the six for the first down. It's first and goal to go.
You know, Bill, Woody Hayes once believed that 3 yards in a cloud of dust was the way to go. The ball control with the emphasis on the ground game. Now he believes in attacking on the broad fronts, going to pass receivers all over the field. There it was, Jan White, the tight end.
First and goal to go on the 5 yard line. The full house tee in the backfield for the Buckeyes. There's no score yet. Here's Otis trying to vault his way over the left side of his line. Stopped by Newell, Henry Hill, and Cecil Pryor at about the 3 yard line. Incidentally, this is the start of 8 hours of live television today, and we should be bringing you quite an afternoon and evening. After this game, the World Middleweight Championship final will be coming to you from Rome, Italy, and then we'll be going to the Los Angeles Coliseum for USC-UCLA. Now it's second down and three on the 3 yard line. Ohio State threatening Michigan's goal line. Hand off to Otis, and he's buckled at the two. Henry Hill, number 39, was the man who made the stop. Michigan has already been called on defensively to make a valiant effort, and they stopped Ohio State on fourth down on the 10 moments ago, but after a brilliant run back of a punt by Larry Zelina and several subsequent plays, the Buckeyes are down there threatening again. It's third and goal to go on the one. Otis, touchdown for Ohio State. Jim Otis scoring the 34th touchdown of his career, the 16th this year, and he puts the Buckeyes, number one in the country, in front, 6-0.
And not too surprising, the tendency has been that inside the 10-yard line, Ohio State will get into their full house backfield and keep feeding that ball to Jim Otis. Touchdown number 11 for him.
Stan White back to try for the extra point for Ohio State. The score coming, 7:38 to go in the first quarter. Snap a little low. He gets it up, however, and it is no good. It is off to the right. ABC and the NCAA combine to celebrate the centennial year of college football. And with timeout, the score, Ohio State 6, Michigan nothing.
A demonstration on a frozen Wisconsin lake of Goodyear's four-wheel control on ice. It starts with new Pathfinder tires with safety spikes added for the front wheels. And Suburbanites with safety spikes added on the rear. Versus car number 3 with conventional rear winter tires. And car number 2 with conventional rear winter tires with safety spikes. Now all three cars are deliberately driven slowly at only 20 miles per hour. Look what happens when their brakes are applied. Cars 2 and 3 skid badly, simulating accidents. With Goodyear's new four-wheel control, this car stops. For this extra margin of safety on ice, get new Goodyear Pathfinders for the front and Suburbanites for the rear of your car.
Now getting ready to kick the ball off, Stan White. And the deep men for Michigan, two speedsters, Billy Taylor and Glenn Doughty. Both can run the 100 in about 9-7. It's a short kick, and Doughty takes it at the 18. Breaks to the 30, goes to the 35, and is pulled out at the 44-yard line. He almost broke away. Had it not been for Ted Provost, number 46, and Mike Sensabaugh, number 3, he might have gone.
We remember him from a game earlier in the year against the University of Washington. Doughty had a big day that day, not only as a runner, but on returns.
Michigan now has field position lead for the first time.
They do, and I should say that Doughty at one time wanted to be a defensive player. He tried to be the Wolfman.
First and 10, Moorhead gives the ball to Billy Taylor, who is stopped in his tracks by Dave Whitfield. Taylor is the boy who wears number 42. He's just a sophomore. He had a shoulder separation early in the year, and we did not see him, as a matter of fact, when he played against Washington, or when Michigan played against Washington. However, his shoulder mended after the Michigan State game in which Glenn Doughty was hurt. Taylor was called on to start against Minnesota. All he did is, since that time, has gained 200 yards per game. Second and 9. Moorhead fires. He's got Oldham at the 47-yard line of Ohio State. Ted Provost and Mike Sensabaugh bring him down. Mike Oldham is a sophomore from Cincinnati, a big rangy fellow, 6'3", 200-pounder.
And this is what we'll see Moorhead doing. The sprint-out pass to the right, throwing the simple sideline cut to Oldham, another man who has come on very well since midseason.
Third down and 1. at the 46-yard line of Ohio State. First penetration by Michigan into Buckeye territory. Handoff goes to Billy Taylor, and he picks up the first down at the 43-yard line. Paul Smith, number 74, making the stop. The first down of the Wolverines in this ball game. First and 10, the ball on the 43-yard line. Ohio State leads 6-0. Pass complete to Mandich, the captain of the Michigan team, the tight end, and he struggles to try to get that extra yard at the 36-yard line. Mike sends the ball, and Ted Provost bringing him down. Big Jim Mandich comes from Solon, Ohio. He's a senior, has never tasted victory over an Ohio State team. Gain of about 7 on the play.
He told us in the pregame show that this is the game he wants more than any other one, and I think we saw just how much he wanted it by that second effort on the last reception.
Second down and 3. Man in motion is Gabler. Handoff goes to Craw, the fullback. And Craw gets to the 32-yard line before he's dropped by Paul Smidlin and Jim Stillwagon. It's a first down for Michigan. And the Wolverines have proved they can at least move the football against these tough Buckeyes. Ohio State has only allowed teams 77 yards per game on the ground. Truly an amazing statistic. First and 10 for Michigan on the 31. Ohio State leads 6-0. Handoff goes to Taylor. Taylor dropped inside the 30 by Tim Anderson. Michigan is the only team that Ohio State has faced this year that can boast a rushing attack that is among the national leaders. The Wolverines are ranked 7th. With an average of nearly 280 yards per game, Ohio State is ranked 2nd with 320. And get this, Texas, top rated with 382 yards. You'll see them against Arkansas 2 weeks from today for the Southwest Conference Championship here on ABC. Second down and 8. Moorhead fires down the middle. He's got Mandich at the 21-yard line. First down. Lamka brought him down along with Sensabaugh. And these Michigan fans are going crazy.
Here it is, one of those patterns we talked about. Tight end Jim Mandich simply running the curl or the hook pattern, finding the open area, and Don Moorhead right on target.
4 minutes and 40 seconds to go in the first quarter. Ohio State leads 6-0, but Michigan has a first down and 10 on the 20-yard line. Take handoff, get him to Gabler. Gabler gets another first down inside the 10 to the 9-yard line. Brought down by Mike Sensabaugh. John Gabler playing in the right halfback spot, a senior from Royal Oak, Michigan. That's only the 20th time he's carried the ball this year. He's not used very much, and therefore, perhaps he's not been scouted very much on that particular play.
And a little bit of razzle-dazzle with the counterplay, the wingback coming underneath after some excellent faking by the quarterback, Don Moorhead.
Mike Hankowitz has gone in as what they call a quick end, number 81. He's at the top of your picture on the right-hand side of the line. First and goal to go. The ball is on the 9-yard line. Michigan trails 6-0. Keeping the ball is Moorhead. He gets down to the 3-yard line and worms his way to the 2.
And Michigan perhaps taking a page out of Ohio State's book that time, going to the full house backfield inside the 10-yard line, and Moorhead running the option play.
The ball is placed squarely between the 2 and the 3-yard line. The Wolverines of Michigan, trailing 6-0, are 2.5 yards away from a goal line that has not been crossed very much this year, protected by the valiant warriors of Ohio State. Second down. Handoff. Touchdown for Michigan. Bobby Crawford carrying it into the end zone for the touchdown.
And you talk about pandemonium. Here it is.
It's all tied 6-6 as Michigan took that kickoff up to the 45-yard line. And in 10 plays, mixing them up between running and passing, the Wolverines move 55 yards to try for the extra point. Frank Titus is back. It's good, and Ohio State trails Michigan now by the score of 7-6 with 3 minutes and 35 seconds to go in the first quarter. Timeout here at the Michigan Stadium at Ann Arbor. The score now, Michigan 7, Ohio State 6.
When a man gets up in the morning, I want to tell you he's ready for a hearty breakfast. Hi, I'm Paul Chrisman. I'd like to tell you about Wilson's Certified Bacon. This is the bacon that's made to build the kind of muscle that football players need. You know, it's protein-rich and loaded with the energy a guy needs for putting in a very long day. It's the heartiest, leanest, best-tasting bacon that you can find. You see, the Wilson people care about the meat they use. They take marvelous meat going in, so they come out with marvelous bacon. The kind that looks good in the pan and tastes great on the breakfast plate. Wilson's certified bacon. Why not tell your wife to try some tomorrow? And if she comes home with a different brand, send her back for Wilson certified. Just remember this, it's the marvelous meat that makes the big difference.
For the first time since 1 year ago, Ohio State is trailing in a football game. They trailed Michigan, as I mentioned earlier, 7-0 a year ago and won 50-14. They now trail by the score of 7-6. Tom Campana and Larry Zolina, the two receivers, and Michigan's Dana Coyne will kick off. 3:35 to go in this first quarter, and Ohio State getting in position to get the ball. Zolina up to the 20. Pulled down on the 26-yard line by Tom Darden and Mike Taylor. Numbers 35 and 33 and number 97 getting off there for Michigan also had a hand in it. That is Moore, Eddie Moore. So Ohio State now will go to work with the ball on the 26.5-yard line. First down and 10 to go.
And they're in a very unfamiliar position.
Jankowski splits off to the left side. In the backfield behind the quarterback are Otis number 35 and 22 is Leo Hayden. Rex Kern on a forward handoff gives to Gillian, number 11, and he gets up to about the 28-yard line. Marty Huff making the stop, along with Henry Hill, number 39. Bo Schembechler on the sidelines here, 39 years old, in his first year as the head coach of the University of Michigan team, formerly coached by Bump Elliott. A wonderful program here in the Michigan Stadium today. I'd like to show you the cover a little bit later on. Second down and 7. Kern on a draw play, hands to Otis. Finds it a little bit tough going over the left guard spot. Gets up to about the 32-yard line before Marty Huff, number 70, brings him down, and number 39, Henry Hill. So a key situation coming up for the Buckeyes, who trail 7-6. Third down, about 4. Zolina has gone back in the backfield for Gillian. Number 82 is Jankowski coming out to the right side this time. Rex Kern, number 10, the quarterback. Third down, 4. Back to pass is Kern. Drills one down the middle. He's got it. A miraculous catch by Zolina at the 41-yard line. But there is... Nope, I thought there was a penalty marker. There's not a penalty marker down. Here it is in slow motion.
Well, you said it. Miraculous indeed. Great concentration by Larry Zolina, who, as we pointed out, is one of the great athletes on this Ohio State squad.
I thought I saw the penalty. It was an interference call, so the pass is complete, even though Zolina did make that fine catch. So it's a first down on the 42-yard line for Ohio State. 2 minutes, 20 seconds to go in the first quarter. Gillian is back in. The wingback spot now, replacing Zolina. Hand off to Otis. Stopped by Henry Hill and Pete Newell. Number 55 in there. In on the stop, that's Cecil Pryor. Henry Hill's going to be a mighty tired young man after this afternoon is over, number 39 for Michigan. Not particularly big for a middle guard, is he, Lee? He's only 5'11", just around 210 pounds.
But he has great quickness and strength, very much like another former Michigan defensive lineman, a guy by the name of Tom Keating. You probably remember him.
Second down and 9, remember him well. Back is Kern, throws a short one in the middle. He's got his man in a cross cut. It's Jan White. Down to the Michigan 40. And the stop made by Brian Healy, number 24. First down for Ohio State, and look at this one again. What a fine pattern.
And here's the diversification of the Ohio State passing game. Jan White on the crossing pattern, the throwback from Rex Kern. And Ohio State again moving into excellent field position.
That was some defensive play by Brian Healy, who had to hand fight a blocker in there. Here's Jan White from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, who's limping off the field, apparently a little shaken up. First and 10, the ball on the 30-yard line. Ohio State trails 7-6. Kern hands off. Breaking through is Otis. 10 quick yards off the right tackle spot and brought down by Barry Pearson.
And there again is the bread and butter of the Ohio State offense, the off-tackle play, Jim Otis. Set up, of course, many times by the excellent faking of Rex Kern and a great surge by the Ohio State offensive line. Otis has now carried 12 times in the ball game for 34 yards.
And that gain was for just under 10 yards by about a foot, as you can see where they placed the football on the 20 and a half yard line. 7-6 is the score. Michigan out in front. And there is the record we told you about. It seems almost fitting, doesn't it, that these two great old rivals should set the all-time college football attendance record here today, 103,588. And just look at that crowd. Well, coming up tomorrow, you'll be seeing highlights of many of the outstanding games today on College Football Today's highlights at 12 o'clock Eastern Standard Time over most of these stations. Ohio State and Michigan will be seen, Dartmouth and Princeton, Missouri and Kansas, Nebraska and Oklahoma, and Penn State at Pitt. Then, of course, live this afternoon from Los Angeles Coliseum, our colleagues Chris Schenkel and Bud Wilkinson will be on hand, bringing the game between USC and UCLA. And while Michigan and Ohio State battle for the Big Ten title in football, it's kind of interesting to note their successes in other sports. Today, Michigan and Ohio State have won an awesome 40 NCAA team championships, including 21 in swimming. Second down and one on the 20-and-a-half-yard line for Ohio State, trailing in the ball game. Hand off fake, and Kern gets the first down to the 18-yard line, and Brian Healy brought him down along with Tom Curtis, number 25.
Well, Curtis is the man that holds the Big Ten interception record, but you saw there that he has the great instincts for shutting off the run, coming up very fast to stop Rex Kern on the option play before he could get into position to lateral.
So Ohio State trails 7-6 with a minute to go in the first quarter, and the Buckeyes have the ball first and 10 on the Michigan 18-yard line. Handoff almost bobbled by Leo Hayden. He just barely had his hands on it before Henry Hill and Pete Newell hit him, but he did not fumble. On the bottom is number 82. That is Pete Newell. Gain of about a yard on the play. On the 17. Hayden checks out of the lineup. Tom Campana, number 24, sophomore from Kent, Ohio, is in there. There you see the Buckeye leaves awarded for individual great plays during the season on the right side of Rex Kern's helmet. Here's Kern pitching back. It's fumbled. Zelina recovers the ball, however, but just barely before he was pounced on by number 29, Barry Pearson, to number 35, the Wolfman, Tom Darden. So it brings up a third down. And about 14 yards to go. There's a tremendous amount of intensity here on both sides.
The third and long yardage now. Kern's tendency has been to go to the sprint out pass.
And that is the end of the quarter. And listen to this roar in the Michigan Stadium for both teams. At the end of the first quarter, the score, Michigan 7, Ohio State 6.
When you're young, the idea of growing old is almost make-believe. You know it, but you don't feel it. Here. On stage, the lines help. Tomorrow and tomorrow creeps in this petty pace from day to day. But in life, tomorrow turns into today so fast.
I grow old while you're watching me.
So do you.
Tick-tock.
Time. And worrying about the future. Because people depend on you. Life insurance is a flexible way to take care of them. Their living, their education. Have you provided adequately? How long would income from your present life insurance provide the things you want for your family? What was enough yesterday? Maybe too little tomorrow. Review your program in this light. Life insurance. When someone's counting on you.
Bill Fleming along with Lee Grosskopf back in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor. And can you imagine the reaction at football stadiums around the country when that first quarter score is announced? Michigan 7, Ohio State 6, and Harris Kern on a 3rd and 14. He's got Jan White at the 15-yard line. Missed at the 5. Touchdown for Ohio State. Tom Curtis missed him. Brian Healy missed him. And Jan White simply out-sprinted everybody to score for Ohio. And on the first play of the second quarter, the Buckeyes regain the lead.
As we said earlier, we're seeing two of the real great tight ends in Jim Mandich and Jan White. And there again on the crossing pattern, Rex Kern nailing him. And a good effort sprinting by two defenders to get into the end zone.
You know, Rex Kern told me that Jan White has never played on a losing football team either in the Little League, in all through high school at Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, or at Ohio State. What a record. Here's Stan White back to try for the extra point. There's a marker down. The ball is up. It is not good. Signaled by the official. Offside, Michigan. Now, let's see. The negative signal was given on the try. So the ball will be half the distance of the goal line, from the 3 to the 1.5, and it's quite possible, Lee, that Ohio State may try for 2 here.
I was thinking the same thing, and don't be at all surprised if they do, that the man to watch is either Jim Otis or Rex Kern on the option.
Score is 12-7, Ohio State in the lead, and now here comes Kern back in the lineup, and there's your answer. Kern normally is not in the lineup on the try for point if they're going for just the conversion by placement. So he's got Otis and Hayden in the three deep spot along with Zelina. Kern looks to the end zone, being rushed. Can't get it away. Tremendous rush by Mike Keller, number 90 of Michigan, forces Ohio State to relinquish the two that they might have gotten, and it is 12-7. Ohio State in front of Michigan in one whale of a football game. Here's a replay of the touchdown. Individual brilliance by Jan White on the cut, and then after he was being pursued by Tom Curtis.
And watch the speed of White as he turns it on here. With all that size, he still has the ability to shift gears and really turn it on in the open field.
14 minutes, 52 seconds to go in the first half. And Ohio State now will kick off. Stan White, Billy Taylor, and Glenn Doughty are deep. 22 is Doughty, 42 is Taylor. Good high boot, carries down to Doughty at the 3, to the 10. Goes to the 20, down the sideline to the 30, and he's out of bounds in front of the Ohio State bench at about the 33.5-yard line. Nick Roman, number 89, made the stop. Doughty, you'll notice, has both ankles taped white. That's over his shoes.
There are those shoes, and they can run. As you pointed out earlier, he has sprinter speed, good shiftiness in the open field, and he's tough.
First and 10 for Michigan, the ball on the 33-yard line. They're trailing by the score of 12-7. Handoff goes to Taylor, and he gets just over the 35-yard line. I believe that the defensive line of Ohio State has him well scouted, this young man who has carried Michigan to victory on his shoulders in the last 4 games.
Well, they've been very effective in shutting off some of the real fine running backs over the last 2 years. Last year, O.J. Simpson, Leroy Keyes, Ed Podolak, and Ron Johnson. And today they have a big assignment in Billy Taylor.
Second down and 8. Here's Moorhead looking downfield, fires to the sideline. He's got his man. Billy Harris catches the ball at the 44-yard line. It'll be enough for a first down. And Ted Provost made the stop. 14 minutes and 12 seconds to go in the first half. Ohio State leads Michigan 12-7. Here's Harris, junior from Mount Clemens, Michigan.
Running the sideline pattern, and Don Moorhead on target for the 4th time. Moorhead 4 for 4 for 35 yards.
First and 10, fake handoff. Moorhead ducks through the opening, and it closes quickly at the 48-yard line as Mark DeBevick, number 83, brought him down. And number 62 in there was Phil Strickland, the right linebacker. Moorhead having a little trouble with his shoe there as it came off. You'll notice they wear a soccer-type shoe on this artificial turf. Mike Oldham, number 84, replacing Harris at split end for Michigan. He goes to the top of your screen. Michigan comes out with the eye in the backfield. Crawl the near man. Billy Taylor, the deep man. Handoff goes to Gabler. Gets to the 46-yard line. It may be enough for a first down as Mark DeBevick brought him down. First down for Michigan. This is the 14th time since 1926 that the Big Ten Championship has hinged on this particular game between Michigan and Ohio State. And strangely, in the 13 previous games, Michigan has won the conference championship Six times, Ohio State has won it six, and one game was a tie, a memorable one it was, too, just exactly 20 years ago today in 1949, and Michigan and Ohio State tied 7-7. First and 10. Taylor, the deep man, to the short side of the field and is down on the 42. Mark the Bebek bringing him down. Let's take a look at some other scores. Princeton leading Dartmouth 7-0 in the second quarter. No score in the Harvard-Yale tussle. And Brown over Columbia 3-0. Second down and 7. The ball on the 42-yard line. Mike Oldham has replaced Harris. He is split out. Moorhead looks down and throws. He's got Mandich at the 33. Bowls around. Tries to come back and they close quickly. What a defensive secondary as Jack Tatum buttoned him down to the ground. And Mandich was hurt on the play. Hurt his right knee, I believe. The captain of the Michigan team down at the 34.
And there he is again, finding the open area, running first the hook, sliding to the outside. Great effort. And I'm sure all Michigan fans are concerned right now about the condition of this great tight end.
This is the centennial year of college football with timeout. The score, Ohio State 12, Michigan 7. Now we return to our studios for this message.
Want to make a super king-size Salem? Watch. You start with all the country soft, country fresh taste of Salem. Add about this much extra length, and that's it. Salem Super King.
You can take Salem out of the country, but you can't take the country out of Salem. You can take Salem out of the country, but
shopping for a new car? Look to the General Motors mark of excellence. It means features like the locking steering column. General Motors invented it, and now fewer new GM cars are stolen because you can't turn the wheel without the key. The locking steering column, standard on cars from General Motors, with this mark.
GM.
Jim Mandich is okay. The team captain is all right. It's first and 10, and the handoff goes to Billy Taylor. Finds an opening. Goes to the 25. Rides off tacklers. Goes to the 20-yard line. Down the sideline to the 13 or 10. He's out of bounds on the 7-yard line and maybe closer to the 5.
Well, just as we pointed out in the pregame show, Bill, that great leg drive, and what acceleration, determination. He did want that end zone. And here he is, the man that's made a big difference for Michigan, Billy Taylor, the tailback, number 42, off tackle, loses one tackler, another, and another, still fighting, nearly going the distance.
The ball is placed in the 6-yard line after that 27-yard scamper by Billy Taylor. First and goal to go. The handoff goes to Craw. He's close to the goal line, but he's not in as he's brought down by Mike Sensabaugh. Number 3 for Ohio State. Ohio State leads 12-7, but their goal line for the second time in this ballgame is being threatened. Glenn Dowdy, number 44, going into the Michigan lineup for John Gabler. The ball is placed in the 1-yard line. It's second down and 1.
And the man to watch is fullback Garvey Croft.
And the full house team. Moorhead, the quarterback, number 27, calling for quiet. Croft somersaults into the end zone. It's a touchdown for Michigan, and the Wolverines take the lead 13-12. That score came with 11 minutes and 54 seconds to go in the first half. And back to try for the point is Frank Titus. It's up. It sails into the end of the crowd, and it's good.
And Bill, an interesting statistic. That's the 10th time Garvey Craw has scored a touchdown from 1 yard out. He's got a total of 13, but 10 of them have been 1-yarders.
And there you see quite a surprising score, 14-12, the Wolverines of Michigan over Ohio State. And here is the run by Billy Taylor that set it up. Notice how people just bounce off his thick thighs.
That's the key to it, along with his great speed and upper body strength.
Well, don't forget, later on this afternoon, it'll be USC and UCLA, and that should be what they called in Indiana during the basketball day as a barn burner at 6 o'clock tonight, Eastern Standard Time, for the Los Angeles Coliseum. Two deep men are Campana and Zelina. Dana Coyne will kick off for Michigan. 11:54 to go, first half. Zelina is buckled at the 25-yard line. Tom Curtis, number 25, and number 97, making that stop is Ed Moore. Well, this is quite a football game, as everybody thought it would be. Ohio State was favored by 2 touchdowns coming into today's game. But the report in Ann Arbor is that they have never had spirited practices like the ones this week. First and 10 on the 25. Rex Kern hands off. Leo Hayden is hit hard by Marty Huff, number 70, and Henry Hill, number 39. Gain about a yard and a half, call it 2.
Those names are starting to sound pretty familiar. Henry Hill and Marty Huff.
That's an interesting number that Huff has, number 70.
Seems to me there's another Huff that wears that.
Second down and 8. Rex Kern back to pass from the 18-yard line. Fakes the short one, throws deep. He's got Campana. He caught it out of bounds. Out of bounds in front of the Michigan bench. Incompleted pass brings up a 3rd down and 8. And as Woody Hayes talks to Lou McCullough on the sideline, Lou is up in the press box observing from high above, and there's Gillian, number 11, beside Woody Hayes. He's not uncomfortable at all, as a matter of fact, in shirt sleeves today.
No, it turned out to be much warmer than we anticipated.
Went down to about 9 above last night in Ann Arbor, but it's about 43 right now. 3rd down and 8 for the Buckeyes. They're trailing 14-12. Kern fakes short, tries to pull long. Now still looks. He's got Jankowski deep and throws to the sideline, incomplete. It was intended for Larry Zelina. The Wolfman, Tom Darden, and number 90, Ed Moore and Mike Keller were putting the rush on. It makes it 4th down and 8. And for one of the few times this year, the Buckeyes seem to be a little harried. The ball will be a 4th and 8 at the 26 and a half, a punting situation.
And give credit to that Michigan secondary, because it's always tough when a quarterback like Kern starts scrambling around to stay with those receivers.
Mike sends the ball as deep. Harrison and Curtis back for Michigan. High, wobbly, hard-to-handle kick, but it's taken on the fly by Barry Pearson. Barry Pearson gets to the 50, goes to the 40. He may break this one. He's got a man blocking for him, cuts to the 10, and is down on the 4-yard line. What a run by Barry Pearson of Michigan, a senior from St. Ignace. It's on the 3-yard line, 61 yards. This Michigan stadium is absolute bedlam.
You talk about excitement. Here it is, right here in Ann Arbor.
14-12, Michigan leading Ohio State, and they have a first and goal to go on the 3-yard line. Craw, the fullback, is stopped at the 3 and falls forward, his body length to about the 2 and a half. Doug Adams, a junior from Xenia, Ohio, brings him down. Let's take a look at that run by Pearson in slow motion. There it is.
Once again, busting the first tackle. The wall setting up. And watch him in the open field, utilizing his blockers.
Second down on the 2-yard line. Goal to go for Michigan. In motion is Doughty. Kept the ball is Moorhead, and he's in the end zone for a touchdown. Don Moorhead, the quarterback, on the keeper. Gives Michigan its 20th point of the afternoon.
What a surge by that Michigan offensive line to set it up for Moorhead.
Can you believe this crowd?
A lot of things that are unbelievable today.
Frank Titus back to try for the extra point that would give Michigan an unbelievable 9-point lead. It's perfect. Ohio State now trails 21-12 against an inspired Michigan team. Each Saturday on ABC, college football in its centennial year, and with timeout, the score, Ohio State 12, Michigan 21.
Nearly every time you go to the bank, you use something created by NCR's high technology. Things like NCR paper that makes its own copies. Without carbon paper, NCR invented it. And now almost every kind of business uses NCR paper, just as they're now using another product of NCR ingenuity. The new computer family that has brought computers within the reach of small businesses that couldn't afford computers before. The NCR Century Series. And to make its computers useful to more kinds of business, NCR makes business machines that talk to computers. NCR accounting machines, NCR adding machines, and NCR cash registers. To keep track of the money you don't put in the bank. NCR, the National Cash Register Company, and so much more.
Well, here's the run that set up the touchdown.
Once again,
Barry Pearson.
Once again, Pearson busting the first tackle, finding the daylight as the wall sets up, and making two good cuts in the open field.
Only a minute and 44 seconds between scores, between the Ohio State score and the return score by Michigan. Dana Coyne will kick off. We have 10 minutes and 10 seconds to go, and we're still in the first half. We've had a total of 33 points scored in this game with two fine defensive teams. What a game. Zelina goes to the 30 and is crumpled at the 33-yard line by Tom Curtis. How often we have heard, Lee Grosskopf, the word emotion in football.
I think you could sense it the minute that Michigan came out of the tunnel today, just how sky high they were. They were beating each other all over the helmets. We saw it in their practice yesterday, and I think we sensed it yesterday when you were talking to Jim Mandich.
First and 10 for Ohio State, trailing 21-12. Kern is hit hard. Back on the 28-yard line by Henry Hill, and number 90, Mike Keller. Oh, I think that one hurt.
There he is again, number 39, Henry Hill, the man that walked on campus, said, I want to play football. He's turned out to be one of the great middle guards in the country.
9 minutes, 41 seconds to go in the first half of Ann Arbor, Michigan. Michigan leading Ohio State 21-12. Second down and 13. Kern tries to throw, gets out of the pocket. He's missed by Hill, comes to the 35, is hit from behind and pulled out of the 42-yard line, a yard short of a first down. With football drawing to a close, the Big Ten looks to basketball and improving its high national ranking. Big Ten teams have competed in 30 of 31 NCAA basketball tournaments, winning 68% of their games and placing 18 teams in the final round of four, more than any other conference. Michigan will begin its basketball season on Monday night. Rudy Tomjanovich in company. That'll be December the 1st. Here's Kern getting the first down, and he's down on the 47-yard line. For the Buckeyes, first and 10 on their own 47. Zelina checking out of the lineup, and Ray Gillian, a senior from Uniontown, Pennsylvania, wears number 11, checks in at right halfback. Jankowski, number 82, out to the split side. 8.5 minutes to go, first half. Michigan leads 21-12. Handoff, bursting through is Otis. Out of bounds on the 27-yard line, and he's thrown out by Tom Curtis. Jim Otis, one of the most durable of all college football players, bursting through for 25.
Again, the man who's the key, Jim Otis. Here it is, the off tackle. Otis finding the hole, seeing daylight to his outside, cutting there. And going here for the extra yardage.
First and 10 for Ohio State on the Michigan 27-yard line. Leo Hayden gets to the 26. Marty Huff, Mike Keller making the stop. Second down and 8. Well, tickets were at a premium for this ball game when they first went on sale. And they got increasingly more difficult to get, and you can understand why. The fans really being entertained here today. One of the classics in the long history of these two teams. They've been meeting for 72 years. Second and eight. Curran trapped back on the 36-yard line. Pete Newell, number 82, was the man who wouldn't give up, and number 97 was Ed Moore. All the way back to the 36.
And, Bill, that's the best way to shut off any passing attack.
Makes it third down and about 19, and coming into the lineup will be Leo Hayden. Bruce Elliott comes in as a defensive back for Mike Keller.
And with this long yardage situation, I think we can look for Kern to be sprinting out, probably to the wide side of the field, and probably a type of crossing pattern.
Third and 19. Kern looks, throws a lob down the center, and it's incomplete. Intended for Dick Kuhn, number 81. Tom Curtis covering, so it brings up a fourth down and 19 on the 36-yard line, with Michigan leading Ohio State, in case you joined us late, 21-12, and some other scores coming in to us. Penn State over Pittsburgh. You'll see Penn State next week, incidentally, against North Carolina State following the Army-Navy game on ABC. We were just figuring out that you're going to be seeing eight of the top 12 teams in the country just during these past couple of weeks on ABC. Try for the field goal by Stan White from the 43. It'll be 53-yard attempt. He's only made one out of five. And the ball goes down into the end zone and out of the field of play. So with 7 minutes and 5 seconds to go in the first half, it's timeout here in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, Michigan. And the score, Michigan 21, Ohio State 12.
Hi there. How'd you like to step up into a Chevrolet walk-in wagon? You would? Great. Watch this. Open the gate. Put your right foot here. Just stand up straight. Swing your body clear. You didn't get it. Listen, I don't do this for everybody. Hit it, Alan!
Open the gate, put your right foot here, just stand up straight, swing your body clear. Walk in America. Open the gate, put your right foot here, just stand up straight, swing your body clear. Walk in America.
Have you got it?
Have I got it?
Walk in America.
Walk in, walk in, walk in, walk in, walk in to Chevrolet.
First and 10 for Michigan on the Wolverine 20-yard line. Michigan leading 21-12. Handoff goes to Garvey Craw, the fullback, and he's down on the 23-yard line by Doug Adams, junior linebacker.
Well, Bill, as Michigan takes the offense again, I think that we should mention that the big thing so far has been their ability to come up with the big plays on defense.
Excellent point. And key defensive plays like stopping Kern for a 9-yard loss on a second down situation. Second down and about 7. Oldham is in the lineup as a split end. In motion is Gabler. Craw on the fake. Moorhead keeps and goes to the 28. Billy Urbanek, number 79, the defensive right tackle, brought him down. In case you lost us just a little bit late, Ohio State went out to a 6-0 lead. Michigan made it 7-6. Then Ohio State made it 12-7. Then Michigan made it 14-12. It is now 21-12 in favor of Michigan. And it is third down and 2. Moorhead keeps, finds an opening. Hit from behind, but he has a first down, and Dave Whitfield just may have saved a touchdown there because nobody in the secondary was in front of Moorhead. He was tackled from behind.
He made a great fake to his fullback and then a great cut coming back across the grain. He's been having terrific luck with the option play, and he's also throwing the ball flawlessly. Here it is again. Now look at Moorhead. There's the fake, and here's a cut coming back across the grain.
First down on the 40-yard line. Moorhead hands off to Taylor. Tries to squeeze through the right tackle spot and fights his way to the 44-yard line. Phil Strickland, number 62, brings him down for Ohio State. And a good look at Billy Taylor. He's got a kind of a bull-like build. He's 5'11", about 198 pounds, big broad shoulders and tremendously thick thighs. And he's just a sophomore.
He is a bull.
Second down, about six. The ball on the 43. 5 minutes, 10 seconds to go in the first half. And please don't leave us for halftime, because I'll tell you, there's going to be a band show like which you've never seen before. Moorhead carries to the 48-yard line. Mark Dubevic brings him down. Moorhead, an understudy to Dennis Brown, had to sit in agony last year at Columbus, Ohio, and watch Ohio State pummel Michigan 50-14.
But he learned well.
Third down and two. The ball on the 48-yard line. On the Michigan side of the 50-yard line, the Wolverines lead 21-12. Well, first down on the 47-yard line of Ohio State. And, of course, what Michigan wants to do now is keep ball control with 4 minutes and 27 seconds showing on the scoreboard clocks in the first half. If they can keep the ball, and, of course, if they can score, it would give them a great halftime advantage.
Moorhead's doing a fine job of mixing his plays now, using the fullback, his halfback, and taking the ball himself on the option.
First and 10 on the 47. Fakes. Moorhead keeps, cuts the corner, goes to the 41-yard line. Incidentally, you look at some of the other scores here. Florida State is leading North Carolina State 13-3. That's at the quarter. Carolina over Duke 7-0 at the quarter. Virginia and Maryland. Maryland leading 7-3. South Carolina over Clemson. And Indiana leads Purdue 14-6 at the half. And Moorhead comes out of the lineup along with Gabler, and Betts goes in for him at the quarterback spot. Now, Betts played almost the entire second half against Iowa a week ago. Clock has stopped. 3 minutes and 51 seconds to go in the first half. While you're watching this game, viewers in other sections are seeing one of three other college football games of great regional interest. This regional Saturday is part of the NCAA television plan developed and refined over the last 19 years. The plan is designed with three major goals in mind: to bring top-grade college football to television, to control the damaging effect that a TV game might have on attendance at 300 other college games the same afternoon, and to spread television participation among as many NCAA members as practicable. To this end, a series of appearance rules have been developed. Each major conference must have so many appearances, and so must the independent universities. And within this framework, ABC selects what it considers the most attractive TV schedule. So far this season, 47 different college football games or teams have appeared on national or regional telecasts. The NCAA hopes that you're enjoying the action here on ABC this afternoon. Second down and four. Moorhead did not come out. Betts was there to replace him, but on the timeout, he simply came to the sidelines, took words of advice from the coach, and apparently they were good words, because it gave Michigan a first down on the 35 with 3 minutes and 45 seconds to go in this first half. Woody Hayes, classic profile on the sideline.
Wayne Woodrow Hayes.
First and 10, the ball on the 35-yard line. Oldham is split out to the right. Taylor cocks over in the backfield, and Gabriel is in motion. Moorhead hit by Stillwagon. Ooh. As he turned the corner, Jim Stillwagon, junior middle guard from Mount Vernon, Ohio. There he is, number 68. Very little gain on that one.
As we pointed out earlier, we're seeing two of the real great middle guards in Stillwagon and Henry Hill for the third straight time. Here he is again. Notice how he takes this blow.
See that lateral movement of Stillwagon? And there's Tatum right behind, number 32. We didn't even see him. He moved so fast.
Who came clear from the wide side of the field, I think we should point out.
Second down and eight. Taylor in motion. Fake handoff. Moorhead fires to the sideline. It is incomplete, just off the fingertips of the intended receiver, John Gabler. Jack Tatum covering on the play. So it brings a third down.
Here he is, the man we've been talking about, Jack Tatum, number 32, the Rover back, one of the top defensive players in the country. Good coverage on Gabler.
This could be one of the real key downs in this ball game. It's third down and eight with 2 minutes and 47 seconds to go in the first half. Michigan wanted to keep this drive alive, not to give Ohio State the ball. Moorhead on a good fake. Rolls, comes out, got Mandich at the 20, goes to the 10, and he's inside the 10-yard line at about the 8. Provo and Sensabaugh brought him down, and the Wolverines have a first and goal to go on the 8-yard line.
Excellent call, the fake of the draw, and going to his most reliable receiver, tight end Jim Mandich. Here it is again. Moorhead, the fake, the draw. We're isolating on Mandich, number 88, finding the open area on the sideline cut. Down inside the 10-yard line.
First and goal to go on the 8-yard line. Handoff to Croft. Fake handoff. Beautiful fake. And Moorhead keeps and goes to the 5. Doug Adams brought him down. Boy, did you see the way Croft covered that?
Oh, boy. Between he and Otis, you have two real good fullbacks for faking. Number 27, Don Moorhead, having one fine afternoon.
See those little footballs in the back of his headgear? That's the comparable award of valor that Michigan gives. Ohio State gives Buckeye leaves. Michigan gives little yellow footballs. Second and 4. 1:53 to go on the first half. Michigan leads 21-12 and threatening again. Handoff goes to Darby Craw, the fullback. Sends the ball, bringing him down. Darby Craw has started 25 straight ball games for Michigan ever since the middle of his sophomore year. Timeout called by the Wolverine stops the clock. 1 minute and 33 seconds to go, and the ball is on the 2.5-yard line with third down. You can imagine what is going through the minds of the Buckeye rooters. You know, an amazing statistic is that Michigan has lost the ball, Lee, only 5 times on fumbles and only 7 times on pass interceptions all year. That's a total of only 12 times that the Wolverines have given up the ball on an error or a mistake. Now, Ohio State has lost the ball 6 times on fumbles, had 11 passes intercepted for a total of 17 for the season. So in this department, at least, Michigan did hold an edge coming into the game, and strangely, there has not been a fumble or an interception.
And right now, with third down and a big play coming up, I think we can look for Don Moorhead to either go to the option or to a play pass, and maybe to his most reliable receiver, Jim Mandich.
Okay, as a former All-American quarterback, we'll test your knowledge here, sir. Third down, 2.5 yards from the Ohio State goal line. Seldom has there been a more brilliant defensive team than Ohio State. All 11 started the season. They started today's game. They're in there right now. And they're really being called on as Moorhead is stopped by Smidlin, number 74. Pushed back to about the 3.5 or 4-yard line. And Tim Anderson also in on the stop. Michigan calling for a timeout. And the question here is now, do you go for 3 points, leading by 9, or do you try to get it in for the big one?
And that's just what Don Moorhead's going to be talking to Bo Schembechler about.
That's the Michigan side of the field on this sunny afternoon in Ann Arbor. 103,588 fans have jammed their way into the Michigan Stadium. It's been a record press coverage, 600 requests for press credentials. Isn't that amazing? Well, apparently the strategy is formed. Moorhead trots on back out. The ball is on the 3-yard line, and the last play lost a half a yard. That offensive line has Mandich, Harpring, Baumgartner, Murdoch, Calderazzo, Deardorff, and Mike Oldham. Up there doing the blocking for Moorhead, Taylor, Craw, and Gabler. 1:23 to go in the first half. Fourth down and 3. Taylor in motion. Moorhead looks, throws in the end zone. Touchdown as Mandich caught it right in front of an Ohio State fan. Jim Mandich, the captain of the Michigan team, caught that bullet pass, and I'm sure it might have singed his fingers a little bit, Lee.
What a shot. Moorhead sprinting to his left.
Wait a minute, there's a marker down. A marker is down on the play. They're talking to Ohio State. It's against Michigan. So forget the touchdown, even though the touchdown sign was given. The linesman ran over to the referee, and it was a procedure penalty. There it is, right there.
As we see it again in slow motion, Moorhead on the sprint out to his left, setting up quickly, pumping, finding his tight end, Jim Mandich, across.
Here is Tim Killian, who has made 5 out of 10 in the field goal department, kicking from the 15. It'll be a 25-yard attempt for the Wolverines. It's up. It's squarely on the way, and it's good. So the Wolverines, because of the penalty, have to settle for 3 instead of a potential 7. But it still makes the score Michigan 24, Ohio State 12, with 1 minute and 15 seconds to go in the first half in the 66th renewal of this long rivalry, a rivalry that has seen many great players from both sides. Both bands, of course, will be performing here at halftime, the Michigan band and the Ohio State band. Those of you who saw the Buckeye band last week against Purdue were thrilled by their performance. Those of you who saw the Michigan band in the earlier game that we did in Ann Arbor against Washington wrote us many encouraging and complimentary letters about that band. So they'll both be performing here very shortly. 1:15 to go in the first half, and the thing that is uppermost in Ohio State's mind is to get that football and get back on the scoreboard with at least another one. That was Coyne getting ready to kick to the deep man, Campana and Zelina. Michigan leads 24 to 12 on the 25-yard field goal by Killian. A wobbly kick that bounces on the 20. Campana picks it up, tries to cut deep, and is hit at the 20-yard line by Mike Keller, number 90. And on the bottom, number 14 of Michigan is Gusich. Other scores, Notre Dame leading Air Force 7-0. That's a quarter score. Toledo and Xavier, no score. Missouri 21-0 over Kansas, one of our ABC regional games today. 1:10 to go, first half. Kern gives the ball in the draw play to Otis. Otis comes through to the 33-yard line on a great burst to the 35. Ed Moore and Mike Keller brought him down. Clock is moving with 64 seconds to go in the first half. Ohio State trails Michigan 24 to 12.
The Buckeyes going to their hurry up or 2-minute offense with no huddle.
Kern looks to the sideline, rifles one, it is almost intercepted. Tom Darden, the Wolfman, number 35, almost had that football. Bruce Jankowski was the intended receiver. Stops the clock, 56 seconds to go in the first half.
And how he would have liked to have had it, because it was clear sailing right to the end zone. As we look at it again, Rex Kern on the sprint out and the near interception by the Wolfman, Tom Darden. There's the hand on the ball, and as you see, there's daylight up front.
Second down and 10, back live now. Down the middle is the pass. It's intercepted by Michigan. Number 25, Tom Curtis, who leads in Big Ten interceptions, takes the ball and goes out of bounds at the 32-yard line, and the Wolverines still have 46 seconds showing on that clock. Tom Curtis of Michigan.
Tom Curtis, the man who set the record last season with 10. He had 7 the year before. And coming into this game, if memory serves me correct, he had 3.
Seconds to go. That's the 24th interception for him, and I believe he is only 5 short of the all-time record set over a 4-year period. Al Broski of Illinois. First and 10. A long deep one. Down deep is Harris. Batted away on a brilliant defensive play by Ted Provost. That will bring a Buckeye leaf, I am sure, to the helmet of Ted Provost, who is called Ted the Tree Provost because he has so many up there now.
I'm sure he added another leaf.
Mike Oldham has gone on the lineup for Michigan as the split end. 41 seconds to go in the first half. It's second down and 12, and the Wolverines would like very much to get up there once more. Oldham down deep, and the pass is intercepted. Sends the ball, has it, for Ohio State, and he's snagged at the 40-yard line. So the team's trading interceptions here. And with 31 seconds to go in the first half, Ohio State takes over. Here is the humiliation bowl news that the Ann Arbor students made up. Incidentally, there was a cartoon in the Detroit Free Press yesterday, I believe it was. It had Woody Hayes at the control of a huge steamroller, and a Michigan football player was dressed right in the path of it, and Woody was saying, "We'll make a pancake out of you." And of course, all the fans here on the Michigan side were saying, "No pancakes, no pancakes." That was a big cheer early in the game. On the draw, Jim Otis, pushback. His forward progress was to the 41-yard line. Henry Hill leading that defensive charge. 17 seconds to go in the first half. and Ohio State calls for timeout. There's 39, Henry Hill. Watch his charge.
An indication, once again, of how emotionally keyed Michigan is. Look at this gang tackling, led by number 39, Henry Hill.
Timeout called here by Ohio State. They're trailing 24-12. We get a quick mention about the events to follow here on ABC today. The World Middleweight Championship fight live from Rome. Luis Rodriguez against Nino Benvenuti. And then the UCLA-USC game coming to you live also from the Coliseum in Los Angeles. 13 seconds to go in the first half. Kern is back. His team trails 24-12. It's caught by Campana. Campana spins away, comes to the sideline, gets out of bounds to stop the clock with 4 seconds. A fine piece of strategy by Campana after catching it. And it's on the 42-yard line. Curtis and Pearson forcing him out. So time enough for one more play. ...17-yard gain on the play. Campana going out. Zelina coming in to the Ohio State backfield. Michigan almost willing to give them the short pass, but not wanting the big one. With 4 seconds to go and Michigan leading by 12 points. Kern throws a deep one down the middle. It sails very deep. It's intercepted by Michigan. And that is the end of the first half. Wait a minute. A safety is called here. Wait a minute. That was a sign for a safety. It is a touchback, right. I thought for a moment that he had caught the ball inbounds and stepped back into the end zone. Which, of course, if it had been determined that he had given the impetus to him stepping into the end zone, it would have been a 2 point. But that is the end of the first half. No points scored. The automatic touchback on the intercepted pass. And a great roar went up from the Ohio State side, thinking they had to, but they did not. Through the tunnel. And first half, all we can say, Lee, is phew.
Amen.
There's a great halftime of entertainment coming up. The score here in the Michigan Stadium in Ann Arbor, Michigan 24, Ohio State 12. Well, I'm sorry for that because you missed a lot of fireworks. Michigan is leading Ohio State 24-12, and both teams have gone into the dressing room. And just remember, we still have another great 30 minutes of football coming up. Right now, the Ohio State marching band is on the field. The theme of their halftime show today is movement and music. And when you couple movement to music, it adds up to 8 minutes of sheer enjoyment. So right now, this band, directed by Dr. Charles Spahn, is on the field, performing before this record crowd of 103,588. The drum major is Wayne Long. The student band members numbering 144. Music you're going to be hearing is an original bolero composed by Richard Heine. Thank you. the band moving toward the far side of the field will form a geometric pattern. And you will hear the familiar can-can from the Tales of Hoffman by Offenbach, done 1969 style by this fine Ohio State University marching band. With an international flavor by the French composer Jacques Offenbach. And we have kind of an international flavor today on ABC because immediately following this game, we'll be bringing you live from Rome, Italy via satellite, the World Middleweight Championship fight between Nino Benvenuti, the colorful Italian, and Luis Rodriguez. That'll be immediately following today's game on ABC's Wide World of Sports. And the Ohio State Band marching off the field on the far side after a fine halftime show put on by the Buckeyes. And now the Michigan Band comes out from the end zone at the north end of this huge Michigan stadium. The Ohio State-Michigan NCAA football game is being brought to you by Pan Am, the world's most experienced airline. The airline that makes the going great. By Chevrolet. Chevrolet is on the move with great new models for 1970, including the exciting cars in your Chevrolet dealer sports department. By NCR. Creators of the famous NCR computers, cash registers, accounting machines, and adding machines. NCR, the national cash register company, and so much more. And by Allstate Insurance Company. For insurance to protect your car, your home, your life, health, and business too. Talk to the good hands, people. Now the University of Michigan Marching Band, under the direction of Professor William D. Ravelli. Assistant director is George Cavender. And they're coming onto the field now to perform their halftime show. Seven company fronts to four giant swords. Incidentally, once a year, the Michigan bandsmen create their own show. The students make up their own show. They choose their own music, sometimes arrange their own music. And this is their original conception for the year of 1969. The theme of the show is Peace in Our World. Now's the time for us to bear our swords into plowshares, as the PA announcer says. And the band presents a swing waltz arrangement of What the World Needs Now is Love, Sweet Love. Music up, up, and away, which of course is very appropriate right now in terms of our space program with our astronauts due back on Monday afternoon for a splashdown after what has to be a marvelous and very successful mission, their lunar mission on Apollo 12. This happens to be in honor of Apollo 11 for our first giant step onto the lunar surface. That's the limb, by the way, of Apollo 11.
On a bleak and lonesome plain near the moon's equator stands a squat, flat-top monument. The four-legged descending of Apollo 11 lunar module. On its side is a plaque with this inscription. Here, men from the planet Earth first set foot upon the moon.
Stirring rendition of the music from the Space Odyssey movie, and incidentally, those classical lovers might be interested to know that that is the music of Zarathustra by Richard Strauss, played by the Michigan Marching Band under the direction of William D. Ravelli. Now an atom formation with the protons and neutrons and electrons bouncing around. The peaceful uses of atomic energy and music is Aquarius.